Okay, thank you very much. It's my pleasure to be here and to present the last talk. Tikhona. And so I've decided to change slightly the title. Actually, it's a small projection back. Probably I will say a couple of words about confidence band estimation, but I decided to speak about a little bit more simple stuff, just parametric bootstrap. And this is joint work with my Vilova, my PhD student, and she did quite a lot in this project. This is still in progress. We are still writing the paper, but it's more or less completed. And this is a very fresh result, which I would like to present here. So my task is a little bit delicate because I suppose not many of you know much about Bootstrap, but at the same time there is at least one specialist in the field in the room. So I have to balance my presentation between two pages. So knowing nothing and knowing everything. Okay. So this is the structure, and mainly I will speak about multiplier bootstrap in the parametric case. So first, introduction and motivation of the problem. So this is a very classical problem, so the most classical problem at all. So you have your data in the form of a sample, and the only you assume at the moment is that the data are independent. So, the next step, so you want to infer about unknown distribution of the whole data, which is denoted by this capital P, the joint distribution of marginal. And what is supposed that this joint distribution belongs to some parametric family, indexed by the parameter theta. So theta is here p-dimensional, so p is finite number. So the very classical setup, if we would know this parameter theta, we would know the distribution. Okay, if we know, therefore, if we believe in this assumption, the only it remains is to estimate this parameter theta. And the most classical way due to Fisher is to do maximum likelihood estimation, you build log likelihood, which is process of the parameter theta. And this log of the measure p theta with respect to some dominating measure, doesn't matter which one, and computed at the point of the data. And you select the parameter theta, which would maximize this probability to observe what you observe. So this is a maximum likelihood principle, and because the data are independent, you can decompose this log likelihood in the sum of log likelihoods for individual observations. So this Li of theta is a log density of I's observation by I. So this maximum likelihood estimation in theta TO is a point of maximum L of theta. I drop here Y just to indicate it's a function of theta. Y is fixed. Y is what we observe. Okay, so this is a classical estimator. Most of estimator can be put in this framework. This is Q is for quasi, and what this means, in fact, we don't believe that in this parametric assumption. This is made to simplify our life, but in reality, PA is PW. Some of you probably know what this means, so PW is probably wrong. So, in this situation, what you really estimate is a projection or Kullback projection of measure P on the parametric family theta. So this theta star is indicates the measure P theta from this family, which is closest to P in the Kullback metric. Okay, this is all classical stuff. Running example for this presentation is something like generalized linear model. So you have the model of this form where I follow the distribution from the given family, and the parameter v here is a scalar product of theta with a vector of feature psi I. So if we would know theta, we know this linear combination, we know the parameter of the distribution of pi. And then the log likelihood can be written in this form, and we code it in the form L I of theta. And this includes Gaussian, Poissonian, Bernoulli regression, exponential regression, volatility model, and many others. Okay, so this is a rather general framework, except that this regression function is assumed to be linear. Okay, now I will switch to the problem on confidence estimations. So I remind you that our target is theta star, is a point in the parametric family which maximizes the expected log likelihood. So if you write it down, you will see this is exactly the definition leads to closest point in the perpendicular distance to the unknown measure p. And theta tilde is supposed to estimate this parameter theta star. But what we want to do, we want to compute on the place of the data the confidence set which contains this point theta star with a prescribed probability. This is what is called confidence set. So this is likelihood ratio construction for confidence sets. You just look at the maximum likelihood. L of theta tilde is the maximum of L of theta. So this is a maximum. And you look at all points which deviate from the maximum, at which likelihood deviate from the maximum by the prescribed value z. So if this difference is not too big, it always non-negative because this is maximum. But if this difference is not too big, then this is something reasonable, and we assume that theta star is reasonable. So coverage probability by this definition is probability that this E of Z covers the point theta star, and of course this can be spelled out as the probability that the difference between maximum likelihood and the likelihood of the true value is not too big. So this is a probability, and the question is now to invert this relation. Given alpha, we want to find z such that this probability is not the inverse probability is not larger than alpha. So what we want to achieve, so here unfortunately it's wrong, it should be 1 minus. Sorry for this. This should be approximately 1 minus alpha, and this is exactly the question which I would like to speak about. Okay, now how it is done in the framework of classical parametric asymptotic approach. So there is one of the probably most fascinating results in statistics, which is known as Wilks phenomenon. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this, but I just explain very briefly. If we take twice this difference, this log likelihood at the maximum likelihood minus likelihood at the true value, whatever the parametric family is, whatever the sample size is, this distribution is close to chi squared with p degree of freedom. P is a parameter dimension. So it is called phenomenon because it's really something conceptual. So this right-hand side doesn't depend on anything, only on the dimension of the parameter space. The left-hand side of whatever family you take, whatever the sample size is, it is always close. And on the base of this convergence, what you can do, you select z alpha as a 1 minus alpha quantile of this chi squared, and this is exactly what you are looking for.
Some smoothing distortions?
No, a little bit.
Taylor.
Okay, we will cut to this.
Okay.
You will see all this Taylor. Don't worry. Okay, but it's quite general. So you are right. But so I mean, parametric family, it is your family, so why should they not differentiate? Now, what is the advantage of this? So this property is called pivotality. That's the right-hand side doesn't depend on anything. So your limiting distribution doesn't depend on the parametric family or the underlying measure. You can do it once for a while. And even compared to other procedure, even you don't need to estimate the variance of the estimated theta field. It's really automatic. So nice result. But all of this breaks down immediately if your parametric assumption is wrong. Unfortunately, it's really heavily designed to the case that the parametric family is a true family. Family is fixed, n goes to infinity, then it works nicely. Otherwise, it's totally wrong. All of this, but even if it is true, the convergence is unfortunately slow. So you need also huge sample size. So now I come to my story. So what I would like to look at, this is actually a challenge, to mimic this situation when model misspecification is very likely. Sample size is limited and the parameter dimension is large, potentially grows with the sample size. So this is the challenge. Okay, so what I did last time, I tried to apply to this problem so finite sample approach, which can partially address all these challenges. What is the essence of this finite sample approach? So this a series of my papers, and the main result is called Wilks expansion, and it says more or less similar things as here. So here you see this is weakly converged to chi squared. What I see here, this difference twicely is close to some quadratic form. If this psi here would be standard normal, it would be exactly chi squared.
How p depends on n? If it's linear, that is not good enough. It should be very slow with n. Dependence p of n should be very slow with this formula.
It is that it is. So I can only say it's there are counterexamples. You cannot do it. So if p grows with n, then you have to be careful. And you can improve it a little bit if you take square root of both sides. If you take square root of the difference minus norm of psi, it is p whole square. So a little bit better. So you can accompany this with a deviation bound for the norm c, where norm c is non-Gaussian and non-standardized. So you can compute the quantile function, but unfortunately, this function depends on the moments of psi, and which are non-available, and some other constant, and the bounds are conservative. So this approach doesn't solve the problem of confidence estimation. It's very helpful, but only for theoretical analysis.
But these inequalities are with probability 1?
No, it's with dominating probability. Oh. Something like this type of probabilities. I will show you the result, the precise result in a moment. Now I explain you a story how this problem can be solved. And we will show you a rigorous result. So the way how to address all of this, finite sample, Gronlund's dimension, model misspecification, all in one. Okay, and this is done by applying the procedure which is called multiplier bootstrap, which is in fact a version of the original FM procedure dated by 79, and the results are of course are very much in flavor of what has been done all the time in this bootstrap community, but there are some specific features which I will show you next. Now I explain what bootstrap is doing. So now what we are doing, we have our data. Data are random. But now we have to split our head in two parts. very strictly. One part for wild data, and another part will be for artificial data, which are your U1 to UF. So now you freeze your observed data, and you generate some other random weights, U1 to UN, which only satisfies these two conditions. Expected value is 1, and the variance is the 1 as well. But the distribution is known. So a typical example could be exponential 1 distribution or normal 1-1 distribution. So univariate weights, you know the distribution, and this E circle means everywhere where you see circle, circle means the distribution of U's given Y. So this means if you see something blue and with circles, this means it is about the distribution of these weights given the data. And now we introduce another artificial process, which is reweighting of the original log likelihood process. Each observation, each log likelihood is taken with a random weights U1, and you sum it up. Now you have this quantity, which is in fact double random. It is random here with respect to Y, L, I depends on Y, but it is random in U. But we fix Y, it only considers the distribution in U. So this process, therefore, it is blue and with circle. This means we'll look at the distribution of this process. Now, it's process of theta. And we know this process. Everything here is observed. So we know this process, and we work with this process. It's just reweighted log likelihood. Now, for this process, we compute new estimator, theta tilde circle, which is a random with respect to U's, not Y's. Now, Y's are deterministic. They are fixed. Only U are random, and this theta tilde circle is a point of maximum of this process with respect to theta. Okay? So this is the maximum likelihood estimator in the bootstrap world, which is completely done by ourselves. We constructed this bootstrap world, and in this world we can compute the estimate. But in this world there is some specific feature. If you take the expected value of this log likelihood, what we see here, we take expected value here, expected value of U is 1. And what you get after taking the expected value, you will get original log likelihood, which is in the bootstrap world, it is not random, it's just a function. And if you maximize this guy with respect to theta, what you will get? You will get theta tilde. So, and the conclusion is theta tilde is maximum likelihood estimator in the original world. In the bootstrap world, it is the truth. It's a true value in the bootstrap distribution. So what is the benefit of introducing bootstrap? In the bootstrap world, you know everything, including the target, what you want to estimate. Okay, so theta tilde, the interpretation is estimating the original world and the target in the bootstrap world. Okay. Now, what we can do? Now we can repeat the procedure which we did in the original. What we can build the confidence sets in the bootstrap world. So, we can compute this statistic, which is a maximum of log likelihood, bootstrap log likelihood with respect to theta, minus the value at the true point. We can compute this, and now we want to find the value zip circle of alpha, which gives this inequality. But now we can do it. Why we can do it? Because we know the truth. We know this value. We can check whether this inequality is fulfilled. Here, in this inequality, everything is known. You can check this, and this is just a quantile of the distribution of this statistic, which is completely observed. So this is the advantage of the bootstrap world. And now what we do, in this ideal world, we get the value, and we put this value, we believe that it's a good one, and use it for the original log likelihood ratio testing. So we put now this value to apply it to the original test statistic, and we believe that it works. So this is the original F1 idea. Okay, but why it works and whether it works is exactly the question. Okay, some literature, related literature. So I cite very recent, so very important and some recent results. The literature is huge, impossible to cover at all. It was in one walk. So I might so related wild bootstrap, which invented by Wu. And for me, the main contribution was done by Hedvin Lamen, 93, and by Enno, 93. On the theory of wild bootstrap. So the property of this multiplier bootstrap procedure were studied by Chatterjee and Goles, 2005, in slightly different context, and for a conditional moment restriction by Lavon and Patillier, 2013. And there are a couple of related results with multiplier bootstrap, which are non-asymptotic, exactly in my case. So one is on Lockdown-Shar, okay, 2010, for a very special problem of Gaussian estimation in some non-Euclidean norm. And probably the most related paper is by Chernozhukov, Chetverikov, and Kata. And so our presentation is really parallel to that. And but they focus on one special model and look at very high dimension. So we will consider a general model, but we have dimensionality restriction, which are totally different, and technique is also different. Okay, now this is the main result. So this is a kind of mystery that, and this result can be called bootstrap validity, which says that if we compute the critical value in the bootstrap world, it applies in the original world. And there is an error term, error of approximation, which is explicit, and you can control all the components of this error term, and you can judge about all the issues. Modeling bias, growing dimension, sample size, all of this enter explicitly in this error term. And so this talk is invented to study anatomy of this error term, effect of model misspecification, and maybe I say a couple of words about extension of the
probability. And dominating probability in the wise.
Yes, device. Okay, now it's a very long introduction. Now I will be short with the essence, but I hope you get some feelings. So this very brief repetition, what we know, this is a real world. In the real world, we have log likelihood, maximum likelihood estimator, target value, confidence set, and this confidence, and this is coverage probability, which we would like to know. And we want to find the value z, which provides prescribed coverage probability. Now we do the same in the bootstrap world. So now we have fixed data and random weights. We build bootstrap log likelihood, bootstrap estimator, the target value, which we know. Not necessary to compute, the max. And now we compute the Z circle to as quantile of this test statistic, which is completely computable, and apply to original test statistic. And the theorem says it works. This is a scheme, very rough scheme, how it works. So in fact, you can go either this way or that way. Two passes. So what is written here? This is a test statistic which we study. Now, by square root Wilks expansion, which I briefly showed you before, you can approximate this difference by the norm of some non-Gaussian vector. This is just a norm of one non-Gaussian vector. Then, with zero mean. Then you can do Gaussian approximation and approximate this non-Gaussian vector by a Gaussian one with small error of approximation. Now you can do the same in the bootstrap plot. There is square root Wilczek function which gives you a non-Gaussian vector. Then you approximate this by Gaussian vector, and what you have here, norm of one Gaussian vector in the real world, another Gaussian vector in the bootstrap plot. And what you do need to do to put these two words together, you have to close this path. This is called Gaussian comparison. Compare the norm of two Gaussian vectors. So this is the idea. So this is now I try to spell out each step of this picture. So the first step is square root Wilczek function for the underlying likelihood in the real world. So this is just brief notation, and this is the square root Wilczek result, which is mainly in my paper 2014 in the square root form, and it says that this difference, maximum likelihood minus likelihood in the true value can be approximated by the norm of vector xi, and this vector xi is nothing but a standardized score. This means d squared is a full Fisher information matrix, which is a Hessian of the expected log likelihood at the true point. And you normalize the score, which is gradient of the log likelihood at the true point, with this matrix. So this is very classical construction. If the parametric model is correct, this vector psi is asymptotically standard norm, like in the central limit theory. But what is said here, so this is a non-asymptotic version of the Fisher theorem, or Wilczek theorem, which says that this difference can be bound by explicit term, diamond, with this probability, at least on the set of at least this probability, this term can be bounded by p plus x over square root.
You subtract the Rayleigh vector, not Gaussian, but Rayleigh, square root of half square. Will it be better?
This vector psi is explicit, so we cannot play with it. So it is completely described. So theorem is not exists some vector. This is just this vector. And theorem says with this vector you have this expansion.
So meaning there is some universal constant of before p this.
Yeah, of course. This sign means time scale. But constant is absolute. Depends on the condition. No, depending on the condition.
Depending on the
condition. And the condition, so you have some smoothness and exponential moments, and there are constants here, and they enter in this.
Yeah, exactly.
And you need some identification condition. Maybe I don't speak much about this because this is a subject of separate talk. There are some tools to do this, so you need to do localization, you need to do Taylor expansion for separately for stochastic and deterministic part, and for stochastic part you need to invent a theory of empirical processes in the vector form, very, very involved, to get the read of this local linear expansion of the log likelihood. So you do gradient of the gradients of the likelihood standardized, and what you claim is this is approximately the linear function. So this is key result in this issue, rather involved, but it makes the main contribution in the technique. Then you need a large deviation bound. In classical statistics, this is Scott's square root normality of the square root n consistency of the maximum likelihood, and here it is done in the non-asymptotic form with precise exponential bounds, but this is in my theory it's only a technical step. And based on this you can do Fisher expansion of the maximum likelihood. So this is in the classical statistics, this Fisher expansion would give you asymptotic normality, because the vector psi is asymptotically standard normal. What you see here, square root of the Fisher information matrix times e to the tilde minus true value is approximated by the standard normal vector. So if you look at this Fisher expansion, you can derive from this asymptotic normality and even more than normality for maximum likelihood estimation. And you see here, this is two lines from this linear linear approximation. So it's very simple. And you can get the Wilks expansion, which is here with explicit error term, and square root Wilks expansion, again with the explicit error term. I just show you this diamond. Diamond is exactly what is shown here. This diamond controls this quality of the linear approximation. And this diamond appears everywhere in all the bounds. So this guy you can compute explicitly, and this guy will enter in all the bounds. Okay. So this is the first step to do square root Wilks expansion in the real world. Then you have to repeat this in the Butzer world. Now, what is the difference? We fix wise, we now play only with U's. So we take the log likelihood, and you look at this expression and try to approximate by some other vector, C0. And the definition of this vector is very much similar. You take the gradient of the score, you remove the expected value and normalize by the square root of the Fish transformation matrix. But in the original world, what you do here, we subtract here from here expectation of this guy with respect to y. Now you inspect, you keep it, it is now deterministic. You cannot take expectation of it. Instead, you multiply by the weight centered by 1 because it's expected value of 1. So this is another random process in which only y's are random. And these guys are deterministic. And for this, process, you can again do Taylor expansion, something like this, and you can get all the result in the parallel. I probably again skip the details, and I show you the next step of the diagram. Okay, look here. So this is the same diagram which I presented before. You have now two vectors xi 0, which are explicit, based on the original log likelihood. And what you can say here, what I'm doing, what I want to study here, is nothing but the normal psi here in the real world and the normal psi circ in the Butzer world. And these two vectors are given. And moreover, this is some vector sums, which you can explicitly study. Now the next step, because it's the sums, if you have sums, you can expect any sum can be approximated by something Gaussian. The next step would be Gaussian approximation. Again, in the real world and in the Butzer world. Okay, so this is the one general result about Gaussian approximation. I show you this theorem, which is somehow related to what Volodya explained in his presentation. So suppose you have some vectors, epsilon i's, which are independent at zero mean with finite third moment, only third moment. And you look at the sum, s is a vector sum of this epsilon i's, I from 1 to n. Now what you are doing, you take another vectors, epsilon I tilde, which are normal with the same first and second moments. This means epsilon I zero mean and with the same covariance as epsilon I. And you build another sum, which is of course Gaussian sum. And what you do, you approximate the norm of S by the norm of S tilde. And this result says that if you slightly modify the quantiles in the right direction, you can get this bounce from below and from above. This delta is a parameter you can select, can be small, and delta n is the error term here, it is written here explicitly, something like sum of third moments. If everything is standardized, I will show you in the next slide, this guy is really small, and how small it is written somewhere, I will show you a bit later. Maybe I skip this here. In fact, this delta n in the typical situation is of order p square root of p cube over n.
Let me
machinery you use, but for such type of situation, there is a Slepian type identities for two Gaussian vectors.
It's Slepian will come later, but it's for two Gaussian. But here is not two Gaussian.
Epsilon I, I'm sure.
No. No. Again,
epsilon actually is Gaussian.
Epsilon I are arbitrary zero mean finite circle. Slepian will come later. Same here, but it will come. So epsilon I is zero mean. So three moments. We take this sum and this Gaussian sum. And what we don't do Slepian, we do Lindbergh telescope. And with this Lindbergh telescope, what is the idea? You smooth out so this probability is expected value of indicator applied to the norm. It is twice non-regular, singular, because it is singular because of indicator, it is singular because of the norm. And what you do, you smooth it out, you use some special function of this type, which approximates indicator of the norm, and you apply Lindbergh telescope device to this function, f, which is smooth. And after doing this, you get the result of this form, and what that you can bound the indicator from two sides, so this function, smooth indicator, can be bounded between two indicators, with a shifted parameter by delta, and with this serialized expression, you get the bound. So I don't go into the details. It's minor modification of the classical Lindbergh device goes back to 22. Something like this, and the error term is of this order, square root of p cubed over n. Quite slow, but still. Again, you cannot approach this. Now, the last result is what Valentin mentioned, is now we have Gaussian approximation in the real world, you have Gaussian approximation in the Bootstrap world, you have to put them together. But what we realize here, so maybe I show you the diagram once again. Here, this is the diagram. These two vectors are with different covariance matrices. Okay? And you, for this approximation, you pay a little bit in quantile. So what you have to verify is that the distribution doesn't change much if you slightly move the quantiles and if you slightly change the covariance matrix. And this is exactly what is done by this trick, which we did applying the Pinsker inequality instead of Slepian. So what we say here, if you have one Gaussian vector, one Gaussian vector with the covariance matrix sigma and another one with the covariance matrix sigma circle. And if these two vectors deviate, these two covariance matrices are close to each other, this means the ratio of two matrices is close to its identity. Then you can approximate the quantiles or distribution of S and S circle explicitly. So what is written in this result? Again, so this is what we do in two steps. One, I put together, so you do approximation S by S tilde, and then I approximate S tilde Gaussian vector by another Gaussian vector S circle. And this Gaussian vector with another covariance matrix, but under this condition. So the trace of the difference, by the way, I forgot here, should be square. Then this trace is small. Then you can control this with three terms, and these three terms control different things. Maybe you can look at here. And this is very nice bound. Maybe it's the last result I show you in such details, because it's very important. So here, look, S is a non-Gaussian vector here, arbitrary sum. And you are interested in the probability that the norm of SDV above the quantile Z. Now you take the Gaussian vector with another covariance matrix and you look at another quantile Z circle. And what you only know is that Z minus Z circle is small. And the covariance matrix of S is close to the covariance matrix of S circle. Then you can get the bound with three terms. This term payment for a Gaussian approximation. This term is the payment for this difference in quantiles. And this term is payment for this wrong covariance matrix. And this you have nice linear decomposition of this character. Okay, so it is, as I said, it is done by Pinsker inequality and computing the Kronborg-Leibler distance with 22,000 vectors. Okay, I don't know, maybe because the time is already almost over, maybe I skip the very interesting part about modeling bias. I just announced that there is a study here, so the story modeling bias is mentioned here, that the bootstrap covariance matrix here, covariance matrix of the bootstrap world should be close to the covariance matrix in the real world, but it's true only if the model is not too biased. This means the distance between the true and parametric family is not too far. Otherwise, bootstrap doesn't work properly. And otherwise.
Bias. I mean, you just estimate the minimum of a function, so it is just an n-estimator. So it's only, I mean, if the model is wrong, you are still.
But this wrong model comes in the quantiles, in the distribution of the Gaussian approximation. So it is written here exactly. So we have the small modeling bias condition. Maybe I show you this calculation very briefly. So suppose I already answered all of the questions. So this is the answer of what the modeling bias is and how to account this. So if you compute the variance of psi, so this is the variance of the school vectors, some of the normalized school vectors here. So and you remove the expectation here. If you can compute the variance of the psi circle, the bootstrap problem, yeah. You get the sum of these guys without saying.
Okay, because it is just a square, not
yeah, and if you take the difference, the difference is exactly bias. And this bias will enter the quantiles, and we have numerical result which nicely confirms this phenomenon. So maybe I show you just the finishing remark, this numerical result. What is interesting here, so it works fantastically well with the bootstrap, even for samples from 50 or 100 observations. And you have to just fit of the quantiles as long as the model is not misspecified. And now we can see that this model of this type here. So you have a regression model with sine function, but your likelihood assumption is that the mean is a constant. This means you approximate the sine function by a constant. Therefore, you have a big bias. Okay? And beta controls the amount of bias. And if you look at the distribution of the... So this red curve is a distribution in the real world of the test statistic. And if the bias is small, this is all realization of the distribution in the bootstrap world. And you see here that the red line perfectly inside. There is no bias. This red line fit together with the red lines. But if you increase the bias here, what you see the shift. The bootstrap critical value are larger because the variance in the bootstrap world is increased by bias. So you see here the quantiles of the bootstrap distribution are all larger.
It's bootstrap is continuous?
Yes. You still can apply it. It will give you at least a prescribed probability, but probably it will be conservative. So this is the essence of the result. here. And the same result you can see numerically. So if the bias increased, we see the difference between the quantiles and the Fischer fold and the real world. So with the bias, it's all start to increase instead of being constant. And so this is reproduced for all the distributions. Now it's for generalized linear models and linear distributions. So we have extension of this for uniform confidence band. And I only say that if you want to do confidence bands, you will come to the supremum of Gaussian fields, exactly as Vladimir are doing with Valentin. And there we apply the modern technique based on Gaussian approximations with identity and anti-concentration. So if you want to do confidence bands, you have to completely change the tools. So what I presented here wouldn't work if you want to do non-asymptotic confidence bands. Okay, thank you for your attention. Sorry for being too long. And yeah, welcome for questions.
Are there questions or comments?
I mean, we could also look at the standard tools because it's.
There are some points where we need smoothness. So it is even more.
I think because I mean, what you can look at it. I mean, that you take the UI as a Poisson variable, and then you can use this Poissonization trick.
No, so even that some of assumptions is hard to share, but it is even now that. So in fact, so it doesn't work. So even numerically, you can see the difference, and in theory, you can see the difference. So we need really this very smooth distribution. Otherwise, Gaussian approximation would be
not just Poissonize your sample size. That
Gaussian approximation trick doesn't work. So I mean you get worse rate in Gaussian approximation. So leading term is coming from Gaussian approximation.
Gaussian?
Yes. No, we cannot do Gaussian. We do Gaussian approximation, and if you do multinomial weights like classical Laplace or Poisson weights, then it will do it worse.
But the Poisson weights are they fulfill your conditions.
No, I'm not sure. So my check and said me that it doesn't do it. Was multinomial in course. I didn't check, but I suspect it's essential to have a continuous distribution. And by Chatterjee and Bose, it's the same.
That's for the UI that you need that
condition. Yes. We need the continuous distribution.
More or less personalization leads to the central limit theorem. Everything is close.
No, lead but radar works. So this is, I mean, we try to get the non-asymptotic explicit bounds. And this limiter telescope multiplier, you get the worse results.
Other questions or comments?
Maybe you know the old, rather old paper of Peter Hohn, where he used also for confidence bands, booster.
No, I mean, there is plenty of papers on bootstrap and so. So all asymptotic, all under parametric assumption, all under smoothing, all with fixed parameter dimensions. So, I mean, you can look at the literature. I showed you the paper which are closely related, but we really went through the stream of literature and checked what is. No, they changed a little bit, maybe much, but the issue of growing dimension is especially changing. So this is really hard to treat. So because you cannot use weak convergence anymore. But approximation worked in any dimension. So this is the effect.
Okay, well, there are no questions anymore, let us end this. Thank you.